Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Okay, so somebody has started to record, it's fine. So we will follow the same procedure what we followed in the previous class. We will use this PPT slide as a virtual blackboard, and I will share my screen now. And things are actually evolving, so it's better. So say, I don't know whether I did it correctly or not. So now the way it will be recorded, you can also see the chat screen where most of the questions will come. So let us get back to the point which we talked. We almost discussed nothing in the first class. We talked about some steady state type of system, this and that, isolated system, open system, etc., etc. We also talked about intensive property and extensive property. We talked about state, and we also talked about little bit about equilibrium. So with that, I don't think there will be any doubt, because there is nothing great I am teaching. There should not be any doubt essentially. So just a quick reminder. So based on the previous day's discussion, we sort of now understand these words. All of you understood it before also. State, equilibrium, these two words well. So we also understood that there can be, equilibrium can be of different types. So you can have a thermodynamic equilibrium. But which sort of covers everything, right? But you can also have independent type of equilibrium, like thermal equilibrium, mechanical equilibrium, chemical equilibrium, radiative equilibrium, and so on. Another important term that should come up here, again, I'm not teaching thermodynamics formally, so I will not go in for a very elaborate definition, is the concept of phase. So everybody understands what is a phase. So if you go by the textbook definition, it sort of says it's a chemically uniform. And these things you don't have to remember or mark for any reason. Chemically uniform, physically distinct. And mechanically separatable. Which may not be fully correct for all cases. So let me ask you a question, a couple of questions maybe. So use the chat box for your reply. Please do not unmute. Though some of you complain that we are not talking, I prefer it that way, because if I ask people to unmute and respond, then somehow it becomes very lousy. I do not, very loudy, which louder rather. I do not particularly like it. So my question is, suppose if two phases and I understand that it is a poor revision for all of you, because whatever we have taught so far, all of you know everything. If two phases are in equilibrium, are all their properties same? This is the question. What's the answer? Great. Sneha, appreciate it. One quick example, there can be n number of examples, right? So the class has the concept correctly. One example I particularly like is, ice and water, of course, but even a slightly more demanding example is two stacked liquids. Of course, this can be in equilibrium only when the density of L1 is less than density of L2, right? Ice and water is perfectly fine. My only intention was to show, in fact, this is a good example of phase as well. So here, what you have two liquids, but they are forming two different phases, right? And they can be at equilibrium. So what would it mean if they are at equilibrium? What are the properties that will be same? So what would you mean if I say a single system, a system which comprises of only one phase? That's at equilibrium. What would that imply? Is the question clear to all? A thermodynamic system or a system its properties become constant with respect to time. Only time? Shivoy, it's only time? Mechanical equilibrium? No, I impose it's a thermodynamic equilibrium. It's a thermodynamic equilibrium. Let me ask a question, glass of water. Is it in thermodynamic equilibrium? Are you sure? I'm not getting any response. Depends on environment, absolutely. So this example we talked, but let me have a feeling. I mean, is the meeting, is the class going well, or because my own video here, the thumbnail that I see is completely stuck. Well, everyone is happy with, you can hear me, right? I do not care whether I am moving or not, but it's fine. Okay, so if a system is in thermodynamic equilibrium within itself, there should be no variation in temperature, no spatial variation in temperature, right? So that would essentially mean something which I think I will pick up a little late. But let's not spend too much of time here. Let us quickly write down one pertinent concept which all of you know, the Gibbs phase rule. It's just for the benefit of completeness I am writing. This is something all of you know, and let us go into the more important discussion. So P is essentially the number of phases. C is the number of components. And of course, F is the degrees of freedom. I have a quick question here. How is this related to this? Or in other words, F and state. How are they related? Number one, are they related? And if they are related, how are they related? What is the relation? We talked about certain things, right? We first talked about state, we then talked about equilibrium, then we talked about phase. Now I'm asking, and phase, everybody knows the phase rule. Sorry. Even drawing a straight line is not that easy in a tab. Yeah, everybody knows about the phase rule, right? So my question is how the degrees of freedom and state are related. Are they related, number one? How? Shoham, think much simpler. And my question is how, it's not how it's related to phase. My question is how degrees of freedom is related to state, and think much simpler. So I just got three answers. Is the question clear to the class? In the previous day's class, no, that is not the answer, Pradeep P. Thakur, that I am looking for. No, there is probably you have never thought about this particular issue in this manner. So if you refer to the previous day's class, right, we talked about state. Everybody recalls and there was no doubt, right? No, I mean, not something Devang that random. It's a very clear correlation. So we essentially know what is a state. We talked about a state, the condition of a system, right? System defining the values of a set, measurable properties, etc., etc., which are sufficient to atomicity. No, much simpler. How do you define a state? Much simpler. And I won't say I'm sorry to highlight, but it's just no. I mean, this has nothing to do with higher mean free path of gases or whatever. Intensive variable. Shayan, very close. Can you zero down the correct answer for the benefit of the whole class? Visibility of the state or myself? Rahul? For the benefit of the whole class, I never realized this is an important question. So let me go a little slow then. In the previous day's notes, when we were discussing what is state, everybody understood? No, Rahul, I don't take that answer. Everybody understood what is state, right? You all know about state variable, right? State variable, path variable, we are about to come. All knows about state variable? Everybody knows about state variable and path variable, right? Exact differential, inexact differential, all of us know. Right, great. So what is state? It's a state of matter. This is what we state. And state, first one is thermodynamic state. Second one is the verb, our statement, verb. So what is state? I discussed, in fact, I do not read out from the book or whatever. But it is the thermodynamic state of a system is defined by specifying the values of set of measurable properties sufficient to determine all other properties, right? So something, let's say, water is at 50 degrees centigrade, okay? What are the properties? So if you know water is at 50 degrees centigrade, there are tables from which you can find out its density, its viscosity, and everything. So what are the minimum properties you need to specify the state? Is water at 50 degrees centigrade a perfect statement to define the state? Yes, Arjav, no is valid. Why it is no? You can take help of the phase rule as well. Water at 50 degrees centigrade, you can take help of the phase rule. Absolutely, pressure needs to be defined. So we all understand that in order to define the phase of water, we need to define temperature. In order to define the exact state, we need to define the pressure and the temperature, right? Clear? Now you substitute whatever you know in the phase rule. It's such a simple question. I don't know why the whole class got confused. What is P? In this, for this particular statement, it's water at 50 degrees centigrade. So it's a single phase stuff, it's liquid. What is C? C is also one because there is only one component, right? So what do you get? You get from the phase rule, degrees of freedom is two. So what is degrees of freedom now? The minimum number of independent variables that needs to be defined to distinguish or define, or that needs to be, not defined, that needs to be specifically mentioned to define a state. Is it clear? I thought this everybody knows. Good that I asked this question. I hope the concept is clear now for good. Is it clear? So why or based on what concept you are telling that you need to specify temperature and pressure? Of course you need to define temperature and pressure. Because when we say water at 50 degrees centigrade, pressure you have to define. It's not a question of pressure not known. You have to define if you want to state. See, 50 degrees water at 50 degree centigrade has no meaning. Why? Because water, if it is at one atmospheric pressure at 50 degree centigrade, will have one set of properties. But if you are suppose compressing it to, let's say, 2 atmosphere, and the temperature is still kept at 50 degree centigrade, properties will be different, right? Even their boiling point will be different. So therefore, pressure is not known is the point thing. Pressure you have to specify. Is it clear? That you need to define at least two. Meaning of degrees of freedom. What is freedom? It is the minimum number of, so since there is a lot of confusion, it seems, I request the entire class to listen to this very carefully. This is one of the most fundamental concepts and a very simple concept. I am actually taken aback with this. So I now again ask a simple question. Water at 50 degrees centigrade. If I want to define the state fully, many of you now agree to the fact that we need to define the temperature and pressure. Is that clear? Or let me draw a quick figure. Right. I will just draw this quick figure for all of your benefit. The class understands they are different, right? What is different? Whatever I have drawn or written, this is clear to all? What is different? Their states are different. Is it clear? Their phase is same. Both are in liquid. Both are in the liquid phase. Their state is different, right? Okay, so now can you from this and using the Gibbs phase rule yourself dig out the physical meaning of degrees of freedom? Anyone? I'm not getting any answers, but I'm assuming that to network related delay. Not intensive terms. Soham, be very Soham. Number of intensive variables, what? What number, Sayan, what number of intensive variable? Ayush, iron, yeah. Minimum number of independent variable that needs to be defined or that needs to be specified in order to determine the state. Absolutely correct answer. Minimum number of independent variables. That is the most important thing. Is it clear to the class? So when you say, I am really happy that I asked this question. So when you say a state, right? How do you define or what are the minimum number of properties? Who tells you what is the minimum number of, it means number of ways state of system depends. No, Snehit, no. It means the minimum number of independent properties, right? It says it means that the minimum number of independent properties, right? That needs to be mentioned to define the state fully. All other properties are functions of this. Is it clear? Great. So, since there is a little bit of doubt, let me quickly sort of move a little forward and pick up something. I can pick it up here also. There is absolutely no problem. All of you know the typical phase diagram. I have no problem because I was thinking of discussing it a little later. So what I'm going to draw, this is also a very interesting discussion. So everybody sort of knows the typical phase diagram of a substance. How does it look? Hey, come on, don't say phase diagram is Y-shaped and all that. Okay, so everybody understands this, right? So what phase is this? See, I'm not very comfortable with this word of Y or mirror image of Y. Let us understand it in simple terms. How many have seen this figure before? Let me check the standard. Let me check the level. Of course, all of you have done great science in 11th and 12th. And then, Rushi Yeravar. Okay, yeah. So here, so the class knows this figure, right? You are conversant with this figure. It's called a phase diagram, but it's actually nothing but a pressure temperature plot. Okay. So if you know that, know it, it sort of reduces my work. What is this point? Great. Wonderful. Let us also write down the Gibbs phase rule. What is the degrees of freedom at the triple point? Zero. Why? Because all the three phases coexist. So number of phases is one, number of components is also one, therefore degrees of freedom is zero. What does it mean? It means for a given system, triple point cannot change. It's an invariant point. Yeah. So there is, There is only one specific set, state, Siddharth. Please do not overcomplicate things. Triple point is an invariant for a given system, for a specific material, whatever that material may be. For a specific material, triple point is fixed. So that we all understand now. Then the class sort of assured me now that they also understand that in this phase diagram, this is solid, this is the liquid, and this is the vapor part of it, right? And what is this point? I would have loved to come to this discussion maybe after 10 minutes, after giving an idea about the energy of the system, because that would have helped me a little in explaining something. So what is this point, the second point? No, not boiling line point. It's the critical point. What is so special about critical point? What is so special about critical point? Or what is so critical about critical point? Condensation is not possible, Samira, absolutely. But be very clear. For any temperature above critical point, condensation of a gas into liquid is not possible, irrespective of whatever pressure you apply. Absolutely. Very good. You cannot liquefy any gas, no matter how much pressure is applied. So Shivoy, Abhishek, Samira, correct answer, all three of you. So this the whole class needs to understand. Whole class needs to understand. Critical point, the concept is known to all. That critical point is a very important point in the sense that above the critical point, whatever, so if there is a if a system has it a temperature above the critical point, however amount of pressure you apply, you can't condense the gas into a liquid. Okay. We will revisit this after we write down the individual terms of internal energy. We will revisit this. Right? That will be slightly later. By the way, what is the degree of freedom at critical point? Are you sure? Ananya, perfect, zero. Degree of freedom at critical point is zero. Get yourself corrected for life. You cannot vary critical point. Those of you who are writing one, it's wrong. Because of the simple fact that at critical point, the number of what is the, how do you get it to be zero? Why do you get it to be zero? See, component is one, it's a single component system. Therefore, in order to, Gaurav, explain kindly why do you get or how P is 3 at critical point? Very good answer, absolutely correct. Of course, P is 3 here. And the clue to the fact why P is 3 is actually embedded in these two dotted lines I have drawn. Very good. So see, at times it really helps to pick up the discussion from one notch below. I did not really think that I would plan the class like this, but it's good that I have. You don't have to refer to any book. You just look into the phase diagram in the internet, a little detailed phase diagram. And that's all about it. You will find that above this particular temperature, above this particular pressure, actually, to be honest, this is the critical pressure. This is the critical temperature. Above critical pressure, even the liquid exists in the form of compressible liquid. If you have a gas, this is called the supercritical fluid or supercritical gas. And here is the normal gas. So essentially, this is how. This is something I am leaving to the class to check out. There is nothing that I have invented. This is a well-known system. So kindly get a good copy of the phase diagram of a single component and kindly look into it and get your concept cleared why at critical point the degree of freedom is zero. Okay, is it clear to all? I won't criticize anyone, but some of you, actually, this is a very important concept, and it is very clear. I'm glad that people are freely making mistakes, right? If you don't make mistakes, you do not learn. You remain within your own mental silo, and you remain stuck up there. You open up. Please, once again, Ayush, what? You please refer to it. See, my drawing is far inferior. After the class is over, just go to Wikipedia. And explanation, I'm coming. Just go to Wikipedia and please look into one good quality phase diagram of a single component system. Right? So as you look into the single component system, we typically, the way we teach in the class, we will draw that Y and reverse Y, all those fundas you were giving. We typically draw that the classifications are only solid, liquid, and vapor. Because most of the time, particularly for people like us who are into chemical engineering and stuff like that, we are at the low temperature, low pressure regime. So we look into mostly the lower part of the system or the phase diagram, and we are quite happy to distinguish it as SLV, the solid, liquid, and vapor. But what happens is, if you look at the liquid phase above the critical pressure, it's called the compressible liquid, right? Can anybody tell what is incompressible liquid and what is compressible liquid? The biotech students are more than welcome to participate, but the chemical engineering students have an edge because you have a course on fluid flow. So what I have written here, and let us also promise to ourselves that we follow a philosophy that every single word I write on the screen or on when I meet all of you and get back to my regular classroom, every single word I utter, every single stuff I write, we must understand. So as a part of that package, what is the difference between these two? Compressible liquid and the so-called liquid, which it's not explicitly mentioned, but implicitly it means the incompressible liquid. What is the difference? Anyone, please? Oh, volume variation with pressure. Come on, man. There is a better term. Very good, Tanmay. Density. For incompressible fluid, like the type of fluid most of you will be handling in your fluid flow course, those are incompressible liquid and therefore density is constant. Yes, density is a function of pressure. That's what makes it a compressible liquid. So you can understand that if you keep on increasing the pressure to such an high extent that the liquid density starts becoming a function of pressure. That is what is a compressible liquid. It's compressible, it gets compressed. Is that clear? So what is the difference now between the supercritical fluid? What is now the supercritical fluid? What does this boundary mean? What does this set of dotted line mean? Liquid's vapor phase does not exist. Incompressible fluid, I'm not fully impressed with either of the answers. The distinction between these two lies here. Well, Mausam, when you say that distinct liquid and gas phase does not exist, right? That's one way of looking into it. There is no clear transition point. But a more important classification is here. How these two are different? How these two are different? One exists below TC. The other exists above TC. So where is the difference? No, Shayan, you are complicating. That's not the answer. It's a very simple answer. So if you are in this part of the phase diagram, right? If you are in this part of the phase diagram, versus this part of the phase diagram, what is the difference? Very good. Adrija, yeah, got it. Critical temperature, of course. My PPT is not visible. Is it not visible to anyone? No, not temperature dependency. That's of course, no. There is a consequence. If a system is at state 1 versus a system at state 2, by this one, the system at state 1 can be liquefied in principle, but the other one cannot be liquefied. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. This discussion is not that greatly important for our understanding right at this moment. The class sort of raised the point why particularly the degree of freedom at the critical point is zero, and therefore I went into it. Now, coming back to my very simple question, what I asked, I did not ask such complicated questions, which I do not understand. So I told you that we have water at 50 degrees centigrade. Is the system fully defined? Is the state of the system fully defined? And the class immediately told me, no, sir, kindly define the pressure. So if I now say I have water at 1 atmospheric pressure, why I'm writing AM, I do not know. 1 atmospheric pressure and 50 degrees centigrade, it's fully defined. It perfectly validates the phase rule, because here what you have, your number of phases is 1, it's a liquid, number of components is 1, therefore your degrees of freedom is 2. And now the whole class understands you need to at least define two independent variables to distinguish the state or define the. So any such point, this point, this point, this point, this point corresponds to such a similar point where you need to independently define, where you need to independently define the pressure and temperature to define the, again, not audible, what is happening today. So everybody understands all these points that we have drawn, all these points we have drawn or identified, right? All have degrees of freedom too. Everybody understands that. You need to independently define the pressure and the temperature. Is it clear? Now, what are these lines? What are these lines? Equilibrium is very generic, very vague. These are phase boundaries. Always use, no, not boiling point line. You use this, these are phase boundaries. You, this boiling point line, Aman, you use this word earlier also. Please do not use that. Yes, if that, that's a consequence that two phase can coexist. It's phase boundaries. Phase separating lines or phase boundaries in the context of a phase diagram. Okay. So now if we take a point, let's say over here. Okay. So this point, let's say the point we have taken is P3. So at the point P3, what are the stuff we have? Yeah, the phases coexist. So what is the C here? It's a single component system. Need to understand that anywhere in this phase diagram, C is 1. That you understand. What is P here? 2, very good. And therefore F is 1. What does it mean? What does it mean that for a system in which the, if it is a mixture of liquid and vapor, right? For a system, if it is a mixture of liquid and vapor, or you can also pick up one example, one point here, right? Let's say this is my point P4, and I draw the figure, which we discussed in the previous class. Right? So everybody agrees that P4 is a system analogous to this, where you have coexistence of solid and liquid, right? So now do you understand if you have a system like this, you can independently specify either the temperature or the pressure. Why? Because if you, let's say, specify the pressure corresponding to this point and say that there is a coexistence of the liquid and solid, automatically the temperature is determined here. Is it clear to all? And therefore, the degrees of freedom is one. Some of you are asking me to repeat on the concept of degrees of freedom. Is it now clear to everyone? I thought this is a very well-known thing and it's a repetition. But is it clear, crystal clear to the whole class now? So that's what degrees of freedom do. Good. Achha, now in this whole phase diagram, we have talked about critical point. We have talked about triple point. What about melting point and boiling point? What are they? Are there some specific point related to, are there some invariant points? Think my question carefully. They are whole lines? No. Very good, Aditya Agarwal. That's the correct answer. Melting point and boiling point are two points that are marked on the phase diagram which corresponds to P equal to 1 atmosphere. Which corresponds to 1 atmosphere. Very good. It's not exactly a line. So I have drawn it something I had already marked. So at P correspond P equal to 1 atmosphere. So this is going to be the melting point where the P equal to 1 atmosphere line meets the solid liquid line, and where it meets the solid vapor line, it's going to be the boiling point. So boiling point and melting point are essentially points with degree of freedom 1. Their degrees of freedom is not 0. This is clear to all? This is a very, very important concept. Many people feel triple point has degree of freedom 0, critical point has degree of freedom 0, and therefore boiling and melting point also has. Aman Kedia, so no means yes or no. You understood or you want me to repeat? Please don't be like writing in a WhatsApp chat. It is not possible to follow. Please remember that boiling point and melting point are pedagogically defined points. Why I say that? Because it's for our own convenience. We live in the world where the pressure is 1 atmospheric. And therefore, we essentially would like to find out the or define the state of anything at two points, where there is a solid liquid coexistence and there is a liquid vapor coexistence. So we are essentially, for boiling point, what is the degree of freedom? What is the degree of freedom? For boiling point and melting point, what is the degree of freedom? 1. Why? What are you specifying? No, it's not 2. It's not 2. Jai Krishna, it's not 2. It's only 1. So what are you specifying? No, you are not specifying temperature. You are specifying pressure. 1 atmosphere. No, those of you who are writing temperature, you are wrong. You are specifying pressure. Pressure is 1 atmosphere and the corresponding temperatures, yes, we specify the pressure. Pressure is 1 atmosphere and the corresponding reading of the temperature, right? The corresponding reading of the temperature from the two phase boundaries, the solid liquid boundary gives you the melting point, the liquid vapor gives you the boiling point. Is it clear to the whole class? So I'm not telling I have taught anything new. Good Saturday's relaxed class, it's perfectly fine. But what it emerges that the all of you should be, for your life, remember that boiling point and melting point are points with essentially degrees of freedom 1. And that 1 is the definition or specification of 1 atmosphere itself. Is it clear to all? Great. Now I have a quick question, again a subtle question also. When I gave this example, nobody objected to the fact, or nobody objected. Or let's not sort of make it too mysterious. Let me make a statement clearly. This particular phase diagram, this generic phase diagram, is not valid for water. Class agrees, disagrees, you know it, you don't know it. It's a statement and it's a correct one. I'm sort of, for once, telling the truth instead of letting people comment on whether it is right or wrong. Sneha, hang on, let your other friends catch up. Very good. So how can you correlate that here? So I got two answers. Not a direct question, direct answer. Does this figure, this phase diagram, so again, I don't never realize that this is an important question for the class. So Shayan says that question is not clear, properly cleared due to net. So let me repeat it. My question is this general phase diagram, which you are telling as Y or inverted Y or slipping Y or whatever, is it a valid phase diagram for water? And then, instead of asking a question, for once I have given a clear answer. This does not capture the phase diagram of water. This is not a phase diagram of water. This particular generic figure does not capture the phase diagram of water. In fact, Mausam has given the correct answer. Water has a unique property. There are many unique properties, of course. So this is the generic phase diagram we drew. This is the generic phase diagram we drew. What modification is needed for making it a valid phase diagram for water? The modification is this. Right, absolutely. So line on left should be towards left is not the right answer, or not a great answer. The answer is for water, the better way of putting it rather, answer is the right one. Slope of the solid liquid phase boundary is negative. Right? You are happy. I have told you what is the correct answer. My question is why? Why or based on what I say that this is not valid for water? Why I say this? And how do you justify? So is now the question clear to the whole class? So I have given part of information, right? And part of a question. So density changes near 4 degrees centigrade, or density of water is maximum at 4 degrees centigrade. You cannot correlate to the phase diagram. It expands when it goes to ice. How can you show that? Let me also, for your benefit, draw one thing. Very good, Animesh. Very good. So Animesh Awasthi and Shanskar Singh, both of them have given an answer. Mausam, repeatedly were emphasizing. Oh, Rahul, what is the bonding structure? Please do not use jargons. What is the bonding structure of water? Do you know that? We know that they form hydrogen bonds because of strong polar interaction. We also know that probably it is not H plus alone, it's the hydroxonium ion H3O plus, but then do you know anything more? And can you correlate the bonding structure with the phase diagram? So this is one habit all of you should get rid of. Telling some high funda science, which sounds great, but you can't explain. You know something, you just write something, you talk. General Janta gets greatly impressed. But yeah, what bonding structure? Can you kindly explain to me how bonding structure is related to this phase diagram? So what special role the bonding... that is fine. 4 degree centigrade is liquid. 4 degree centigrade does not even lie on this line. 4 degree centigrade at 1 atmospheric pressure in the liquid region. It will be somewhere over here. That has nothing to do. There's absolutely nothing to do with the slope. Is density increases, decreases? Are you plotting density here? Is density even considered while drawing a phase diagram? Answer is no. My approach towards science is very no-nonsense. Every word you utter should have a meaning. No question of saying sorry, Rahul. Please do not say sorry. It's a change in the scientific temperament. It's a change in the scientific temperament that is required. Use what you say is some knowledge that you have acquired. And you have acquired this knowledge nicely. Therefore, last year you cracked JEE and you are here. Absolutely fine. Well taken. But now, once it is knowledge, you can get it from the net. You say, what is there? We will just mug it and go. And then everybody criticizes that the education system is based on mugging and it's just reproduction of what you mug. So whether you mug from your brain or you mug for a copy from your cheat, it's all the same, right? So Achal, as the pressure decreases, the water bonded molecules break up and expand. Have you seen it? Yeah, Shiva, your answer is correct. I'm coming to it. There is a particular phenomena. Okay, a lot of gyan free, not free, IIT pays me heavily. All of you, I guess most of you have a refrigerator at home, so can do a little bit of magic today evening. Blocks of ice. Just one second. Two blocks of ice if you take. Press them hard against each other. Those of you who are really inquisitive, all of you are our students, so you all claim you are great, knowledgeable, greatly knowledgeable in science. Each one of you has have creativity at par with Thomas Alva Edison. So why don't you try this very simple experiment today? What is going to happen if you press this? No, melt is not the correct answer. There will be melting, but not only melting. They will join up. Devan, why don't you simply use? They will form a monolith. They will unite. They will form a single block. Breaks like solid? No. No, they won't. Their interface will melt. Yes, show me. Correct answer. They will stick. Not even stick. They become a single entity. They will fuse. Yes, absolutely. Abhilash. Yeah, so anybody knows what is the phenomena called? This is what is called regulation. No, it's nothing to do with hydrogen bond. This is not hydrogen bonding. God's sake. Yes, Karan. The spelling, it's not regulation. It's called regulation. Very good, Karan. Ayush, just the way I grabbed Rahul, I'm asking. Where do you see hydrogen bonds here at the interface? Ayush Iron, where do you see the hydrogen bonds here? Are they visible? They're not. So this phenomena, so they're not visible. Hydrogen bond exists in liquid water. We all know that. So please refine your thinking. The way I am trying to teach science to all of you, I'll be very candid with all of you. All of you know phase rule. You have done it in your JEE preparation and you have done it in your first year science. But many I found today while teaching, and I am a pretty experienced teacher, right? So I understand the pulse of the students. Many I found did not know the inner meaning of degrees of freedom very clearly. When I am teaching a subject, that is not acceptable. You must understand degree of freedom. You all know degree of freedom. You tell what is the degree of freedom. You will calculate it to be 1, 0, 2. And today you realize that degree of freedom is no some great stuff, right? It is just the number of independent properties you need to define a system or a state of a system. Defining a system is identical to defining the state of a system. So I guess it is clear to the whole class. Similarly, we will understand science exactly in the same way. Whatever we are seeing, whatever we are writing, and whatever we are claiming, that is visible to us. Not like some super hi-fi theory, this is happening and therefore it is happening. Nobody knows whether it is happening or not, right? And then people say, ha ha ha, it must be happening. It doesn't go like that. Of course, there are a lot of physical theories like that. People predict, there are conjectures. String theory, for example, is a conjecture. When Satyendranath Bose came up with the concept of boson, it was a conjecture, it was a theory. In fact, that's the reason he did not get the Nobel Prize, because during his lifetime, it could not be validated. Now, after the CERN experiment, it has been validated. So bosons are reality now, everybody understands. Had he been alive, like Peter Higgs was alive for such a long time, and therefore he could get the Nobel Prize for the so-called God particle. So now you see what is happening here. So the whole class, I request those of you who do not know this or finding it interesting, it should be interesting, kindly open your refrigerator of your mother, take two ice blocks, and please try to push them. It's a very nice thing which you can actually impress upon people. They simply join up, form a simple monolith, right? So what is happening? How is it forming a monolith? As somebody said, it is fusing. That's exactly the right word. So we all know that solids have defined boundary, but liquid does not have defined boundary, right? So what happens is, so this block had a defined boundary. This block had a defined boundary. And when this boundary disappears, what is the easiest mechanism by which it can happen? So this is the block one. What happens is, close to the interface, some water forms. And this is the block two. Even over here, close to the interface, some water forms under some specific condition. What is that condition? What are you doing when you are pressing the two blocks? When you are pressing the two blocks, what are you doing? Or let's say these two better examples. You are essentially applying pressure, right? So you now have a system where upon application of pressure or the pressure increasing, right? The system transforms from solid to liquid at the constant temperature. Is it clear to all? And now look into the phase diagram. So if we pick up a point over here and we apply pressure, sorry, handwriting is because of the tab is causing problem. Just one second. So if you pick up a point over here and apply pressure, what happens? It goes up like this. Everybody understands, whoever, and many of you are actually online. So this line represents increase in pressure. Right? And then you can see what is happening in the phase diagram. Is it clear to all that you apply pressure? Then there is a phase transition because of pressure at the same temperature here along the same line. Temperature is constant. Right? So what is happening as you apply the pressure? It goes from the solid state to the liquid state. Right? And then after some time, when you withdraw that force, you reduce the pressure, what happens? It again traverses back the same path and comes back to the same point because to the initial pressure and temperature. But in the meantime, what has happened? There has been a transient period of time where there was liquid over here, right? And that liquid does not have a distinct boundary, right? So when you have reduced the pressure, it has again frozen back to ice. And now it forms a bridge. So it's now a monolith, a single structure. This is what is called the phenomena of regulation. And if somebody now asks you, how can you comment that this particular diagram fails to capture the phase behavior of water? Your answer is, this diagram fails to capture the phase behavior of water because it cannot explain regulation. See what happens here. If you apply pressure, since the slope of the solid liquid curve is positive, here it does not go to the liquid state. It goes to the liquid state, which is obvious due to the phenomena of regulation in water, only because the slope of the solid liquid phase boundary in the phase diagram of water has a negative slope. Is it clear to all now?
I assume there are some network related issues because I'm not yet to get a single answer.
This is how physics is. It's so simple and it's so demonstrable. Okay, so see, we are almost reaching the end of our class, again without teaching anything, but doesn't matter really. So I will just touch up some terminologies which I will need in the next class and I will finish it. So certain terminologies, this place is enough. So we all know about adiabatic systems. Huh, Shubham Kumar, common ice gola making principle, absolutely fine. But see, you knew about ice gola, and then when I asked the question, there was a long duration, you did not give the answer, right? So it's all happening. And the only way I teach, or the reason I teach in this particular way, is to sort of connect you to what you are learning here to occurrences around, right? Science is not disconnected, but we often feel we are making something, some solving some problem, kuch kiya, and then something else is happening. And somebody is asking why there is lightning, and if we don't know why the sky is blue, we do not know, something like that. That should not be there. See, this thing, I request to the class, if any of you have enjoyed this lecture, just try out taking out these two blocks and impress people around you. Everybody will be impressed. So now let me just now back to some very routine and drab stuff, which all of you know. So this will be necessary for us. So we know what is a system. So we all know what is an isothermal system. We know what is an adiabatic system. We know isobaric system. And we know isochoric system. So I guess all of you know this, Q is equal to zero. Isothermal is delta T is equal to zero. Isobaric is delta P equal to zero. And this is, there is no change in volume. The only other thing that I will talk today and then I will stop the class is where I want to check whether the class very nicely and very well understands the difference between state variable and path variable. It is clear to all? Everybody understands what is a path variable? And examples of why it is important for us to know about path functions or path variable? Because as a part of our energy balance, okay, so we need to understand the path variable clearly. Because, so why it is important for us to know about the path variable? Path variable, because of the fact that as we are going to talk about energy balance, there are two important parameters or issues that are involved. That is the heat transfer or the heat, that is Q, and the work done. I thought I would talk a little bit on these two, but somehow the phase diagram got the better of us today. Hope it was not a wastage of time for many of you and many of your elementary conceptual sort of slight distortions are taken care of. So we all understand what is a path variable, something that depends on the path, right? And state variable is, it's independent of the history that the system has traversed, is the instantaneous property. And what is the mathematical consequence of the path variable? Mathematical consequence of the path variable, you cannot write something like delta Q, that is completely wrong, be careful. And we also have inexact differential. Thank you very much.